this morning for a move of the Holy Ghost power from on high. I said, is anybody hungry this morning? Hallelujah. Come on, choir, sing. Good.
Lord, we've been hungry all so long for righteousness.
Lord, we've been thirsty.
Lord, we've been thirsty all so long for holiness.
Lord, we've been hungry. Sing it now. Place this morning. Come on. Are you breathing? I said now, let everything that have breath sing now.
Let everything that have
breath. Let everything that have breath sing.
Oh, now.
Let everything that have breath.
Instruments.
Come on. everything that has breath. Sing now. Come on, Cheryl, sing it. Yeah.
Let everything that has breath.
Sound of a mighty army. Well, now I can hear the sound of a praising embassy. I said, now I can hear the sound of a mighty army.
Come on, let me hear you.
Well, now I can hear the sound of a praising embassy. They're singing, praise him,
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 praise
him. I can hear the sound of a mighty army. I said, I can hear the sound of a praising embassy. Sound of a mighty army. Yeah, yeah, I can hear the sound of a praise.
They're singing, praise him,
praise him,
praise him,
praise him,
praise him in the sanctuary. Somebody praise him in his mighty name.
Yeah, yeah, yeah,
praise him for his mighty deeds.
Somebody praise him on the tambourine.
Come on.
Praise him on the instruments. Praise him with.
Come on, one more time. Come on, somebody praise him.
Is anybody ready for Camp Meeting 95? We didn't work all year long, do all the preparation to play church. We didn't work all year long and do all the preparation just to let the devil get off easy. But I'm telling you, hell needs a headache this morning. I said, hell needs a headache this morning. Is anybody in the building with me this morning? We're going to let him know there's a group of people that believe in the supernatural power of the Holy Ghost. Now, if we're going to see done, if we're going to see done what God wants done, we've got to let our faith rise to a level that we have never seen before, that we've never experienced before. I don't know about you, but I'm ready for faith. I'm ready for faith to overtake me. Somebody say amen.
We'll have faith
in God.
We'll just have faith in God.
You see, I know the Lord, he's gonna work it all.
If you just have faith in God.
Ooh, you gotta have faith.
Have faith in God.
Gotta have faith.
Have faith in God.
Just have faith. see, I know he's gonna work it all out.
If you just have faith in God.
Listen, I said he is just a prayer away.
If you just have faith.
Some faith in this place this morning. Now, I'm not talking about something I read about or somebody told me. I'm talking about myself being in the midnight hour in a time of need when everything else failed and all I had to do and all I could do was hold on to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1 that says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. If you got some faith, get out of your seat. Get down here. I want you to let the devil know that we're going to believe God. Come on. Somebody get out here. Help me rejoice.
Well, you got to have
faith
in God. Come on.
Just.
You got to have faith
in. Come on.
Well, just have faith in God.
Faith in God. I said, have faith in God. faith, steadfast confidence and assurance that God said what he meant, meant what he said. Throw your hands up in the air and shout, I have faith in God. I'm not talking about faith in Abraham. I'm not talking about faith in Isaac. I'm not talking about faith in Jacob. I'm not talking about Peter's shadow, Stephen's signs and wonders, or Paul's handkerchief. I'm talking about faith in the Almighty Jehovah God, Jehovah Nissi, the banner of victory, Jehovah Shammah, the God who is present with me at this moment, Jehovah Shalom, the God of my peace, Jehovah Sidkenu. When the devil says you're unrighteous, he said, that's all right, I'll be your righteousness for you. I want somebody to praise him this morning.
Will you be happy in God? We'll just have faith in God. Gotta have faith in God. We'll just have faith in God. Well, if you trust in him and never doubt, you see, I know the Lord is gonna work it all out. If you just have faith in God,
well, you gotta have faith.
Shakes hell this morning. Shout for it. Shout for it. I feel something coming. I set up. This now. Let me help you. Have faith in God. For truly, that word actually translates surely. Surely. Shall it, surely. I say unto you that whosoever, point to yourself, say, that means me. That means me right now. Right here. It's time. Right now, for my miracle, whosoever shall say unto this mountain, our critics say of Pentecostal folk, you're too noisy. But our song said, he's all over me and keeping me alive. Song said, you don't know like I know what he's done for me. You can't tell it like I can tell it. Hey. How he set me free. Hey. Whosoever, we're going to be loud this week. Somebody said, does it have to be so loud? Yes! Yes, it does! Yes, it does! Woo! Truly I say unto you that whosoever, shall say unto this mountain, Get out of here. Shout, get out of here. And not doubt in his heart, but believe those things that he saith shall come to pass. He shall. Have whatsoever he saith. Therefore, what things soever you desire when you pray, believe. You receive them. And you shall have them. You never prayed the prayer he didn't hear. You never prayed the prayer he did not answer. You can rest assured the answer is already on the way. You may not have it right now, but you can put your foot down, point your finger, and announce to hell's corridors, I shall.
Well, he is just a prayer away.
If you just have faith.
Of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Just stand upon his word, believe in your heart, and you will receive
having
in God. Will just have faith in God. Gotta have faith in God. Will just have faith in God. Well, if you trust in him and never doubt, you see, I know the Lord is gonna work it all. Just have faith in God.
Faith is the substance. I said, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not.
Just stand upon his word, believe in your heart, and you will receive
have faith
in God. We'll just have faith in God.
You gotta have faith
in God. We'll just have trust in God. Well, if you trust in him, you see, I know the Lord is gonna work it all out. If you just have faith in
God. If you trust in him,
well, now if you trust in him and never doubt, you see, I know the Lord is gonna work it all out. If you just have faith in
God.
If you trust in him, well, now if you trust in him and never doubt, you see, I know the Lord is gonna work it all out.
Here this moment. Turn around and tell somebody, I'm saved. Washed in the blood. Anybody baptized in the Holy Ghost? I said, is there anybody baptized in the Holy Ghost? Turn around and tell somebody, I'm full of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. Come on, we're Pentecostal folk. Hallelujah. You may shake hands with seven people. The ushers are counting. They'll throw you out if you don't shake hands with seven. Thank you, Lord. 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 You may be seated. Praise God forever. Praise God forever. Now, for some of you that are unaccustomed, what you're sensing is just the supernatural presence of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. It's been so supernatural in here for 3 weeks. This is always a great church, but I'm telling you, we're under a visitation. Just lift your hands right now at the beginning of camp meeting. Thank him for his presence. His wonderful presence. Wonderful presence. Let's just worship him a little bit. Worship him a little bit. Oh, thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you. Hallelujah.
We bless you, Lord, you worthy.
Thank you, Lord. 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 Hallelujah.
Holy Spirit, we are in your presence, we are in your presence. Fill us this morning, fill us with your power.
Come on, you don't need a sermon, you need him. Come on, you don't need a song.
Come on,
you need him.
Welcome, welcome.
You don't need a healing, you need him.
We are in your presence.
We are in your presence.
Fill us with your power.
Fill us with your power.
Come on and live inside of me.
Live inside of me.
For you're the living water. Come on and sing now.
You're the living water.
Yeah. Come on and sing.
Your power.
Come on,
take inside of me.
this place now.
Fill us with your power.
Spirit, would you come now? Would you come in your fullness, and would you come in your power? Would you come in your demonstration? Would you come in the magnitude of the fullness of your miracle? We are hungering and thirsting after righteousness, and this is our covenant promise that we shall be filled. We desire to be touched with the Holy Ghost, set ablaze of the fire of the glory of God. Heal every sick and afflicted one in this building today. Take away the awful curse of sin. Liberate every captive. Move by your Spirit, we pray. Great Holy Spirit, who made the chaos of the world without God come into order, speak into our lives during this great camp meeting. Change us, we pray. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, turn around and tell somebody he's here. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Dr. Oral Roberts will be here momentarily, and we'll be delighted to welcome him. Right now, there's still enough Baptists left in me to get your money. I'm after your money. Look at somebody, say, he wants our money. Yes, I do. You got enough Reebok tennis shoes, and there are people going to hell I can reach with the gospel if you just give. Yes, sir. I want to tell you, this is a very important announcement. This coming Friday at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, the Holy Spirit has spoken to me. We have been under a divine visitation of God. The fact of the matter is, I have had no need to preach in this church for 3 weeks. The supernatural manifestations of the Holy Ghost have been undeniable. The power of God. I'm talking about services where you say, I want to pray for people who the Holy Spirit said, pray for people whose knees are hurting. People ran to the altar to be prayed for. A man came over here. He was in a wheelchair with his leg out like that, with a cast from his hip to his ankle. I started to pray for his knee, and he knocked me away. He said, Pastor, don't pray. He said, you can pray for that if you want to, but that's not my problem. He said, my problem is I'm a liar. He said, I'm a liar. I go to church 3 times a week, and I can't stop lying. He said, I am full of a lying spirit. I cast the devil out of him right there at the altar, and we saw probably 300 people delivered from demon powers in last Sunday morning service. Yes, supernatural. Well, I suppose in the last 3 weeks, I probably laid hands on upwards of 20,000 people. The anointing of God is so strong and so heavy that I don't want to do anything right now but come out here and grab you. And some people don't even get to the altar. God moved supernaturally the other night. We preached a little bit about 6 being the number of men, 7 being the perfect number of God. And when David picked up the ark and took it back from the house of his friend Obed-Edom, the Bible said he put the ark on his shoulders, took 6 steps, but he couldn't go any further. The glory of God hit him. At the end of the number of men begins the number of God. And when people took 6 steps toward this altar, they were falling out in the power of God all over them. I'm telling you, there's glory in the house. Well, this coming Friday at 2:00 in the afternoon, we used to have a partner reception. I said, I don't want to have a reception anymore. Don't want to do anything. I can't preach and minister to the people. So on Friday at 2:00 in the afternoon, for Breakthrough Covenant partners only. If you are not a Breakthrough Covenant partner, we can't let you in. We believe that the building will just be full, because so many partners come in for this great camp meeting. And I'm not going to do anything at 2:00 in the afternoon but lay my hands on you for supernatural blessing in your life. 2:00 in the afternoon on Friday. If you want to be a part of that service, you have to be a Breakthrough Covenant partner. What is a Breakthrough Covenant partner? A Breakthrough Covenant partner are those that help us stay on. How many of you see Breakthrough on television? They help us stay on 14,000 television stations across America 7 days a week. 14,000 stations. Some of them are $6,000 an hour. The Breakthrough Covenant partners make that possible. You say, well, how much do they give? They give whatever the Spirit of the Lord tells them. We believe and hope that they'll be able to give once a month something, but sometimes they can't. And if they can't give every month, we continue to send them all of the partner materials, which would fill up a wheelbarrow, and I don't have time to go through all of them. But if you want to be a part of that great anointing service at 2 o'clock on Friday afternoon, then you need to be a Breakthrough Covenant partner. If you are not a Breakthrough Covenant partner, you can begin to be one this morning with your first gift of $20 simply to cover the cost of the materials that we'll send you. Or no, we don't even send them. They can get them today. We've got it set up so they can get them today, because inside this envelope that the ushers have for them is a little form. It's a two-part form, a white form and a yellow form. And if you fill it out, then when you take the white form off, you keep the white form, put the yellow form back in the envelope, or vice versa. Because I said so, and it's my church. So you take one or the other, put it in the envelope, take the other one with you to the Breakthrough Partner table in the foyer, and they will go ahead and give you your Breakthrough Partner prayer journal and all of the materials, the lapel pins and the 10% discount card and everything right then when you get it today. So if you want to become a Breakthrough Covenant partner and you are not one, with your first $20 gift today, you will become one, and that will make you eligible to be in that anointing service on Friday at 2:00 in the afternoon. Plus, you'll help us preach the gospel on 14,000 stations across America. If anyone would like to become a Breakthrough Covenant partner today, and you are not one, but you would like to become one, the ushers are going to move through the aisles extremely quickly, because paper is cheaper than time. And if you would like to become a Breakthrough Covenant partner, if you'll just raise your hand right now, they'll distribute those all through the congregation. Just take stacks of them and pass them through there. And if you want one, take it. And if you don't, pass it on. Back there are dozens of folks joining us today. Let's thank these that are becoming Breakthrough Covenant partners with us today. Will you do that? All over the building, the ushers are moving quickly. The rest of you who are ready to give because you believe that revival is not only prayed down, it's paid down, and that the supernatural power of God is manifested by what He does when you obey, and His word commands that you tithe. What is the tithe? 10% of the sanctified gross income. What is an offering? Anything above the tithe. If you need an offering envelope for your cash giving, they're in the pew in front of you. And if you're making out a check this morning, you may get payable to World Harvest Church. Wouldn't it be wonderful if today we just wipe out the budget of this great camp meeting? Several hundreds of thousands of dollars. Let's just wipe that out today in Jesus' name. Amen. I said amen. Amen. I said amen. Amen. Hallelujah. We're still rolling on a wonderful miracle. Easter Sunday, God gave us a miracle. Some of you participated in it. Thank God for it. One supernatural offering, $2,277,000 cash deposited that day to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Somebody asked me the other day, Dr. Roberts asked me the other day, he said somebody wrote out Richard Roberts a check for $1 million for Oral Roberts University. And immediately, Sister Roberts, Evelyn Roberts, she chimed in, and it's already spent. I said, you don't need to tell me about that. We received an offering Easter, and people haven't given since then. They think that $2,277,000 was enough to do us. How many of you know 14,000 times 6,000 is more than two wadded up $1 bills? How many of you can know that? It takes a lot. Maybe you'd like to trade electric bills with me. Mine last month was $22,000 for 30 days. If you'd like to trade, anybody got any takers? Nobody. That's what I thought. What's in front of me are 60,000 prayer cloths sent in from all over America, believing God for a miracle during camp meeting. If you would like a prayer cloth, you may receive those at the information tables in the foyers. Please do not attempt to come up and put anything on this table. These are all marked. They have names and addresses that I have to get these back to 60,000 people. So the ushers will be very guarding of this area. It's a hallowed area. We have them in the altar. There are folks here believing for the most incredible miracles you could ever imagine. And they receive them every year. If you would like a prayer cloth to be on that table, you can receive them at the information tables and then fill it out and give it to the ushers, and they will get it on the table and we'll get it back to you after camp meeting. Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. Somebody shout hallelujah. All right. Now, tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock, we're going to have a glorious service. I don't know who's going to be preaching. Might be Kyle Switzer or Harold Woodson or Mike Perkey or Darlene Bishop, or it might be Van Crouch, or I don't know who it might be. Might be me. I might just get mad and take over the whole thing. Hallelujah. Somebody asked me today when I walked in the building, they said, are you ready? I said, when I came forth from my mother's womb, the doctor spanked my fanny. I said, give me a Bible and a microphone. I'm ready. I'm ready. I came out ready. I'm ready. Hey! But tomorrow afternoon at 2 o'clock, for sure, I'm going to preach for you. So don't miss that. Be here at 2 o'clock tomorrow afternoon. Bless the Lord. Are you ready to give? Amen. Gary Oliver is getting ready. I think the choir is going to bless you. Is the choir going to bless you? Is the choir going to bless us? Okay. Stephanie Dalton is going to bless you. Stand up, Stephanie. She is the wife of our youth director and one of the full-time staff instructors at World Harvest Bible College. Reggie Spires and his lovely wife, Becky. Stand up, Becky. Have just joined our staff about a week ago here at World Harvest Church. They'll be heading up the music department at World Harvest Bible College. So don't miss that. Praise the Lord. All right. Shout, I'm ready to give. I just got a message that Oral Roberts is on the property. You say, well, who told you? My belly. Hallelujah. Are you ready for a miracle? I'm ready. Gentlemen, if you would wait upon the people and welcome Stephanie Dalton.
I see. so selfishly, just reaching out for what pleased me. Even then, God was faithful to me. And when my strength was all gone, when my heart, it just didn't have a song,
everybody. About to join me on the platform is, without exception, what I believe to be the greatest voice in Christian music today. God has kicked a door wide open for him, like the book of Revelation said, "I'll open a door nobody can close." He has just released an album, his first solo album, 3 weeks ago. It's already number 22 on the Billboard charts. The world is taking notice. And it's Holy Ghost gospel music. It's not Jesus is in there somewhere. If you look for him long enough, you might think about you almost saw him pass by. This is Jesus. This is the blood, the cross, resurrection, power, Holy Ghost, glory. Huh? I said, huh? I love him with all my heart. He's more like a brother to me than a friend. That CD and cassette you can get in the bookstore, the World Harvest Bookstore. If you stop by Gary's table, he can give you a coupon for $2 off the brand new CD and cassette. So that's a way you can take care of that. He is a permanent fixture at Dominion Camp Meeting and will always be. We're delighted he's going to be with us all week long. Would you welcome back to World Harvest Church, Gary Oliver. Uh,
Oh, come on and give Jesus a shout of praise in here today. Come on, somebody, give him glory. Give him glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, come on, just get radical just for a minute. How many of you are glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? You're glad to be at Dominion, number two on that song. He really will. How many of you believe God's going to do it for you? How many believe God's going to give you what you need this week? Come on and put your hands together and shout one more time. Know that you struggle with questions in your mind. Fighting for an answer, there's a war all the time. Seems like your prayers are going nowhere. Does God really care? Does he really even care? Sometimes it's hard, the tests you go through, but keep on believing that my God will work for you. I am a witness of what I say is true. Today, I am delighted to be here. The anticipation of my spirit. Come on, somebody. The expectation that I feel. I can't hardly wait to get through this week because I know that there's going to be some incredible change. I know that there's going to be some incredible healing. I know there's going to be some incredible deliverance. I know there's going to be some increase of anointing. I know somebody's going to walk out of here and their church has changed. I know somebody's going to walk out of here and their marriage is going to be put back together. Hallelujah! My God, somebody praise him. Woo. I'm
I'm expecting that. I'm expecting, shout it, I'm expecting it. I'm believing God for it. And so I simply have a prayer that I want to offer the Lord today. We need you, Spirit of the Lord divine.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
let him know you appreciate his ministry to you, please. Praise the Lord.
Gary will be with us all week at Dominion Camp Meeting.
You won't want to miss one service. You may be seated. I'm holding in my hand a 388-page hardback book published by the Thomas Nelson Publishers. It's entitled Expect a Miracle, My Life and Ministry, Oral Roberts, an Autobiography. You may have seen Dr. Roberts on Larry King Live on Friday night, or on Good Morning America on Thursday morning, or any number of CBS, ABC, NBC affiliates across America, as this book is literally blazing across the country. One of the most unique things about it is that it's written in Dr. Roberts' own hand. This is not the work of someone else. It's Dr. Roberts telling his life story. The inside cover says, little Granville Oral Roberts was no stranger to the hard scrapple life of a traveling evangelist. The fifth and youngest child of a Pentecostal holiness preacher, he spent much of his childhood under tents and brush arbors hearing his father preach old-fashioned revival. Reverend Ellis M. Roberts had a vision, but to young Oral's thinking, that vision was too small. Even though he had heard the story of how his mother had consecrated him to God before he was born, Oral decided he wanted more than an up and down fortunes of an itinerant preacher. At 16, he left home with dreams of becoming a lawyer and governor of Oklahoma. Tuberculosis destroyed those dreams and drove Oral home to die. A miraculous healing at a tent meeting changed everything. Not only was he healed of tuberculosis, but the stutter he'd had all his life disappeared. Like his father before him, Oral answered the call to preach. By the time he was 30, he was drawing both crowds and criticism. That pattern has continued throughout his life. Expect a Miracle is the story of that life in Oral's own warm, talking with a friend style, rich with anecdotes, controversy, and testimony spanning 76 years. He talks about the things that made headlines, his older son's suicide, the tragic deaths of his older daughter and son-in-law, the announcement that God was going to call him home if he didn't raise $8 million, and the City of Faith Medical Center he built and had to close. And he talks about the things that didn't make headlines, the support and loyalty of his wife, Evelyn, and of the people whose lives were touched through the many facets of his ministry. About the future, if the past is any indication, Oral Roberts isn't finished yet. The best, he says, is yet to come. I asked Dr. Roberts if he would bring a supply of this 388-page hardback edition by the Thomas Nelson Publishing Company, and he said he couldn't do that. He wouldn't want to presume to do that. So I didn't want to presume, but I just called Thomas Nelson. And they sent a shipment anyway. The book is $20 in the bookstores across America, and I know you don't want to stand in line, so the ushers have them available right now. If you have a $20 bill, just hold it up in the air, and the ushers are coming through the aisles, and they'll hand you one of these beautiful. This is a book suitable for your coffee table. It's a powerful, powerful edition, and they've got it. If all you have is a $50 bill, we appreciate the offering. Thank you very much. So right now, just hold that up. The ushers are moving through the aisles. Right now, why don't you get your Bible ready? You're about to be changed. Gary Oliver, that is one of the most incredible songs I've ever heard in my life. My wife Joni said, finally someone is writing hymns again. It's a modern day hymn. God bless your heart. How powerful. What a tool to reach America. Ushers are moving very quickly because paper is cheaper than time. And I want Dr. Roberts to come and grace this platform. Last year I went way out on a limb, and I contacted Dr. Oral Roberts to see if he would kick off Dominion 94 Camp Meeting. To my surprise, He answered very quickly that he would come. Last year, you remember, he graced this platform and preached a sermon. What was his prop? A pillow. The pillow of faith. We still have that pillow at home. Still believing for tremendous miracles. What a sermon that was. Well, we had the lineup for Dominion 95 camp meeting, this camp meeting. And in my heart, I wanted to contact Dr. Roberts again, but my head said, oh, you couldn't presume to do that. 2 years in a row for a man of that stature to invite to come to the cornfields of Columbus, Ohio. But I sent the fax anyway. And less than 24 hours later, I got a fax back. And Dr. Roberts agreed to come and be with us to kick off Dominion 95 camp meeting. I built this building that you're seated in this morning when I was 29 years old. And I would walk around inside it, and I said, God, I'm going to build it for you, because someday Oral Roberts will preach on this platform. Our gift make room for us. We love Dr. Roberts and Evelyn with all our hearts. How desperately we need them in the body of Christ. A rock to rest our confidence on. Would you welcome once again God's great general, Dr. Oral Roberts. Oh, excuse me. Joining me on the platform is Sister Evelyn Roberts. I love you, Sister Roberts. Last night, Joni and I had the distinct honor of having dinner with Dr. and Mrs. Roberts. And I'll tell on Joni a little bit. When we got out of the hotel room, she said, now I know I'm a worm. She said, I think I've heard that there's a God, but when you're in the presence of God's generals, it humbles your heart. We're honored that Sister Evelyn Roberts is with us today. Would you welcome her as she greets you?
Excited to be here this morning. I'm just liable to dance a little jig. You never know. I've watched this church and your programs on television for so long, and watched Brother Rod preach, and just enjoyed it so much. And I said to myself, someday I'm going to get in that church. This is the day, and I'm so grateful. I'm so glad that you're alive. You're not dead. If you were dead, I wouldn't even want to watch you on TV. But because you're alive and you have the power of Jesus Christ, that's what interests me. I'm so glad to be here and to see all of you and to worship with you today. We have a representative from Oral Roberts University who's with us. Rodiga, where are you, honey? Where are you? Would you come up, please? This is one of our representatives from Oral Roberts University. Did you know that we have an Oral Roberts University in Tulsa, Oklahoma? You know that? Are you a graduate of ORU? She's a graduate. Rodiga, say a word to the audience and then tell them where you're going to be to talk about ORU after this service is over.
Sure. ORU is just such an exciting place to be right now. We are experiencing just so many new growths at the university. We have external degree programs and home education for the homeschoolers out there. And I have all this information outside on the table that has Oral Roberts listed right above it. And I would be so excited to see you guys out there afterwards.
Okay, great. Thank you. Thank you, Rodiga. If you have any children or grandchildren or aunts or uncles or nieces or nephews or family or friends of any kind, talk to them about Oral Roberts University, because to me, it's the greatest university in the world. It's the only charismatic university that I know of in the world. And I'm grateful for all of those who have graduated from Oral Roberts University and who are going to graduate. Are there any people here who have graduated from ORU? Oh, I see one way back. I see two. Oh, Brother Rod, you got to get more than that at ORU. You've got lots of people here that need to go to university. There's some back there. Thank you all for raising your hands. I'm delighted. Some of my children are here this morning. We have about 13,000 who have graduated from Oral Roberts University, and many, many more to come. And we're so grateful for that place. We're grateful for you. We're grateful for this pastor and his wife. It reminds me, he and Joni remind me of Oral and me when we first started the ministry. We were so young, so young. And they've accomplished so much. They're so young to be able to accomplish that much. And I'm just grateful for them. I'm grateful for everything they're doing. When I look at all of these requests for prayer, I assume that's what they are over here, it just makes me want to cry, because every piece of paper there represents a trauma, a pain, an ache, a need in somebody's heart. And it really touches me that you're taking requests for prayer, and I assume you're going to pray over those today. It touches my heart. Because this world is full of need, so full of need today. There's so many hurting people out there. We can't even imagine how many are out there that are hurting this morning. I hope that during this camp meeting, many, many, many of you and these people here will get their needs met, because that's what this is all about, is to get people's needs met. God bless you this morning. I'm delighted to be here. I'm expecting a miracle this morning.
Something good is going to happen to you. Thank you. Be seated. Turn to Luke chapter 18 while I tell you a story. This old prospector in the Rocky Mountains, way back there in the 1880s, had to come in once a month to get supplies. This little town. And he rode his mule in one day and hooked it up right in front of the saloon. Just about the time a bunch of drunken cowboys came out, and one of them saw him. He pulled out his six shooter. He said, "Old man, have you ever danced?" He said, "No, I haven't." He said, "You're going to dance." And he began to shoot at his feet. And I'm telling you, that old prospector danced. But while the bullets were flying, he was counting them. And when the gun was empty, he just reached back to his mule, pulled out a double-barrel shotgun, laid the barrel up on the chin of that cowboy, and said, "Cowboy, have you ever kissed a mule?" The cowboy said, "No, but I've always wanted to." I was conducting this crusade and went out to grab a bite to eat before going out to the big tent, and I kind of wanted to keep a mind on my sermon and all, so I didn't talk. And And people kept looking at me, and I went up to pay my bill, and there's a man right in front of me paying his. And he looked around and said, "You know, mister, if I didn't know better, I'd think you were Oral Roberts." I didn't say anything. He said, "Yeah, if I didn't know better, I'd think you were Oral Roberts." I still didn't say anything. He said, "Mister, it's better to be thought of somebody great than nobody at all." Well, praise God, I feel like I'm home with you, Rod and Joni. They're very special to me. They feel like my children. And Eva and I are, of course, I married an older woman. I haven't told you that, have I? She's 9 months older than I am. Now, she's 78, but I'm only 77. So that makes me 77 years young, doesn't it? Well, darling, you look so beautiful this morning. 56 years. I introduced one day as my first wife, and I heard her say, "And your last." 56 years we've been married. Thank God for it. Look at Luke 18, beginning at verse 35. "And it came to pass that as Jesus was come nigh unto Jericho, a certain blind man sat by the wayside begging. And hearing the multitude pass by, he asked what it meant. And they told him that Jesus of Nazareth passeth by. And he cried, saying, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And they which went before rebuked him, that he should hold his peace. But he cried so much the more, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stood and commanded him to be brought unto him. And when he was come near, he asked him, saying, what wilt thou that I shall do unto thee?" Now that's the line I'll ultimately preach on today. What wilt thou that I shall do unto thee? And he said, "Lord, that I may receive my sight." And Jesus said unto him, "Receive thy sight. Thy faith hath saved thee." And immediately he received his sight and followed him, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw it, gave praise unto God. I'm ministering to you today on the secret of life, of abundant life, is in expecting miracles. Miracles are coming towards you or past you every minute and hour of your life. You decide whether you reach out and take that miracle or you let it go by. You either cultivate expecting that miracle so you can recognize it, so when it does come your way, you can say, "Lord, thank you for that," and reach out and get it. Or you can go through life scripturally ignorant of miracles coming your way, and that miracle will pass right on by. It'll come towards you, but because you don't recognize it and reach out and get it, it passes on by, and you'll hear yourself saying, "Oh Lord, I wonder why you don't care for me, why you don't deliver me, why I don't get my miracle." It is primarily because we don't understand that miracles are coming toward us or past us every minute, every hour of our lives. Nothing has had a greater impact upon Oral Roberts' life, and through him, many multitudes of people. Under a period of great physical danger to my life, when my life hung by a threat that they were going to kill me, that night when I went to the crusade, I was lying across the bed, trying to rest, to keep my mind on God, and not let my emotions get out of control, and really not to back out, not to appear that night, to send an excuse that, you know, something had come up and they had announced that I couldn't be there that night. When the Lord spoke in my spirit, expect a miracle. And I'd never heard that term. I never read it. And he said, expect a new miracle every day. Well, I almost jumped out of that bed because that was the day that I needed a new miracle. I needed the spiritual guts to get up and dress and go to that crusade and face whoever had the gun in his hand, whether I lived or died, to preach as long as I was alive, to expect a new miracle every day from God. And I can say nothing better to you than to expect a miracle. Everybody say it. Raise your right hand and say it. Stand to your feet with your hand up and say, expect a miracle. Now say, Lord, I expect my miracle. Beginning today. Now. Thank you and be seated. I want you to notice that when stories are told in the Bible, they're aimed at you and me. We're told here that it came to pass when Jesus was approaching the little town of Jericho, a certain blind man sat by the wayside begging. Another scripture says that he had a robe on. It was the beggar's robe. In that day, they didn't have the finances to care for blind people or places to keep them. They had no financial support. And because the person was blind, that robe signified that he was blind and was financially unable to take care of herself or himself. And that beggar sat there with the beggar's robe by the wayside begging. When all of a sudden he heard a tumult, a noise, a great crowd was approaching. His hearing was very keen, and he picked up that noise as it increased and got louder and louder, and he asked, what does this noise mean? And somebody said, Jesus of Nazareth passeth by. It was like you turned on 1,000 electric lights inside his soul. Thoughts came to him that he had been carrying for months. He had never seen Jesus Christ. He had not been in his presence. He had missed the opportunities of wherever Christ ministered because he sat by the wayside begging. There are millions of people who have never had an encounter with Christ because of the dreaded thing in their life, the thing in their life that holds them back and holds them down and robs them of their confidence, their self-image, their hope, their expectancy. And there he sat and he heard this noise that Jesus of Nazareth passeth by. And here is a man, although blind, knew the Bible. He knew the prophecies of the Old Testament concerning the coming of the Christ. And without any hesitation, without consulting with anybody, he raised his voice and shouted to the top of his voice, Jesus, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. Why would a blind beggar cry out instantly, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. What would he know about it? Who could have imparted to him that kind of information? And why would he, upon hearing it at that moment, cry to the top of his voice? Because down in his spirit, he knew what the word Jesus meant. He knew what it meant to call him, "Thou Son of David." Jesus was the man, but the Christ was the divine part of him. Jesus was the human part, born of the Virgin Mary, and had come down through the lineage of David, and he was the Son of Man. And the beggar knew, the blind man knew, that because his name was Jesus, that he was a man stripped of his divine nature, who had come down upon this earth to identify with lost and suffering human beings, who came to sit where we sit and to feel what we feel. And he instinctively knew from his being reared in the scriptures that when the Messiah came, he would identify with him in his blindness, in his beggary. He knew that. And so many people don't know that. Sometimes they use the word Jesus as a curse word. Sometimes they use the word Jesus as a fun word. They use it in all kinds of ways. But the name of Jesus is no accident. It is the name of the one person who ever lived, who came to identify with you at the point of your need. I tell you, you're not alone today. You're not sitting there with that torment or that awful thing that you know about and maybe others don't know about and others don't care about. But he knows about it and he cares about it. And his name is Jesus, because he came to identify with you. And he said, "Thou Son of David." Why would he call him Son of David? The great Bible scholars say that David, that shepherd boy who killed Goliath the giant and became the king of Israel, was the most complete man who ever lived until Christ came, until Jesus came upon the earth as a man. David killed the bear and the lion barehanded when they came to kill the sheep of his father. David sang songs in the night. He wrote psalms, and he gave us the songs of the songbird of Israel. David was a man after God's own heart. And he was the man that came against the giant Goliath when even King Saul and the entire army were scared to death of him. That big giant, 10 feet high, and you know how wide, standing there, David picked up the little stone, put it in his slingshot. He just thought the fellow was too wide to miss, and he didn't miss him either. But David was a man that was complete. When he became king, Israel, who had been brought there by Moses and Joshua, had not occupied the whole land that God had laid out. But David extended the land to its farthest extremities. David restored the land. David was the complete man. And this beggar, this blind man, knew Jesus was the complete man. Greater than David, thou Son of David. He was called the son of the woman in the book of Genesis, the one who had bruised the devil's head. He was called the son of Abraham, who was the one who gave us our faith. He was called the son of David. All of this is in the Bible. The son of David. And this blind man sitting there remembered the scripture in the book of Isaiah. It's also in the fourth chapter of Acts. I could quote it to you, but I want to read it. And this was what was in his mind. And I want it to be in your mind today while I'm preaching in Luke 4:18. When Jesus said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me." Isaiah the prophet said that 800 years before. "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. wonder what he said to the poor. I've come to preach to you for you to be more poor. I've come to get you out of your poverty is what he's preaching about. He's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted. He didn't say you deserve that mess you're in. He said, I've come to get you out of it. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted. He has sent me to preach deliverance to the captives. You're bound by something. I'm bound by something. You and I can't get out of it. The devil is guarding the gates, and we don't know how to get out. He comes to break the bars of copper and steel and let us go free. And he said, and recovering of sight to the blind. That old blind boy sitting there that day was quoting that scripture, that this man has come to set me free from my blindness. He personalized Jesus. He personalized Jesus. He personalized Jesus. Have you personalized Jesus? He pointed Jesus right at his need, his blind eyes and his begging hands, who came to recover sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised. All over his body were bruises. All over his mind were bruises. All through his spirit were bruises. Why? Because he was blind and a beggar and kicked and cuffed and cast out. And he was bruised all over and inside. And he could hear him as the Son of David coming to deliver him as a poor man, as a brokenhearted man, as a captive, as a blind man, as a begging man, as a bruised man. And he said to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And that referred to the 50th year called Jubilee. At the 50th year in Israel, all debts were canceled. Everything was restored. And he said, that day has come. Today is now. He is here to restore me everything that I have lost. Nobody here has to wait till tomorrow. You don't have to wait till tonight. You don't have to wait one more second. The year of Jubilee is here. The King of Kings has arrived. He's here to set you free. And he was sitting there saying, Jesus, thou Son of David, have mercy on me. What he needed and wanted and cried out for was mercy. Oh, I've prayed to God, don't give me justice. I've had justice all my life. I don't want any more justice. I've got so many shortcomings and failures. Don't give me justice. Say, Oral, today I'm going to be merciful to you. Give me mercy, folks. Get a barrel of mercy and pour it on me. He said, be merciful. Give me mercy, Lord. Be merciful to me. You've got to personalize mercy. You've got to believe that God is a God of mercy. You've had so much justice in your life until you're vomiting. I mean, justice has tripped you, and justice has robbed you of your sleep, and justice has taken your faith away. It's time to stand up and say, mercy, Lord, give me mercy, because he is the God of mercy. Everybody say, he is the God of mercy. To me. Point at yourself. To me. Say, he's the God of mercy to me. Say it again. And this religious crowd that was following had not asked for one miracle. They had been following Jesus, whereas the poor blind man had been sitting there by the side of the road all those days that Jesus had been on the earth. Day after day they carried him, and he sat on the side of the highway where the people passed by so they would see his beggar's cup and the beggar's robe that he had on. But these other people were more fortunate. They could see. They could hear. They could walk. They could follow him. They could travel wherever Jesus was. And they were the religious people. They were not the spiritual people of Israel. They were the religious people of Israel who didn't expect a miracle, who followed him to catch him in his words, to criticize him, and finally to deny him and see to it he was nailed to a cross. This is the religious crowd following him. And they stopped and rebuked him and said, "Shut up! You're bothering this meeting." And that's what the unbelieving believers do. They say, "Shut up! All this man wanted was a miracle." But they were the crowd that said the miracle stops when the apostles died. Did you know that? The religious people of this earth who followed Jesus after their own fashion say that that miracles did happen back there, maybe, but now, since the last apostle died, it's all over. Now you think about that. How many know who was the last apostle to die? John, about AD 90, on the island of Patmos after he wrote the book of Revelation. And he died in a barrel of oil. They killed him. And so, according to the religious crowd, God stepped out on the battlements of heaven, called all of his angels, his Son, and the Holy Ghost, and said, "This is the cutoff point. There'll be no more miracles." And one angel said, "But Father, there are billions of people that are yet to be born. And they're just like the other people that Jesus came to. But no, I'm going to cut off all the miracles. I'll never heal another eye or open another deaf ear or give a new birth to another human being or baptize another with the Holy Ghost and fire. I will never give another miracle. This is the cutoff point." Now, that's what the religious crowd says. And you are crazy if you follow them. You are crazy if you follow them. Somebody says, "But the church I go to has a preacher that doesn't believe in miracles." It's about time you got a miracle-believing preacher. I heard about this church who got a new preacher, and his first sermon was on miracles. And after it was over, the board called him behind the scenes and said, "Preacher, we don't believe in miracles in this church. And you did very badly by preaching on miracles, and certainly the first time that you preached." And he said, "Well, miracles are in the Bible. God gives miracles. Jesus is in the now," and he went ahead to explain it. They said, "We don't care about that, but you can't preach miracles in this church because we don't believe in miracles." He said, "It's in the Bible." Well, they said, "We don't care about that. You can't preach on miracles in this church." So he said, "All right, I would like to get off to a good start with you people." And he pulled his penknife out of his pocket and opened it and handed it to the head deacon. He said, "I want you to go through the Bible and cut out all the scriptures about miracles. You cut them out." "Oh," he said, "I can't do that. I'd be cutting up the Bible." He said, "That's right. But I still want you to cut out where it says there are miracles for God's people." Well, he said, "Preacher, I can't do anything to the Bible." He said, "But you've got to do it because you said I can't preach on miracles. And if it's not in the Bible, then I don't preach on miracles. So you cut it out of the Bible, then I can get up and I can preach the rest of the Bible and not preach on miracles." And the deacon said, "I don't believe I want to do this." He said, "Here, take your knife back." He said, maybe you ought to go ahead and preach on miracles. Brother, sister, you can't open your Bible hardly anywhere without seeing God doing a miracle. I'm believing in a miracle-performing God. And I want to tell you the cutoff point has not been reached. I stuttered and stammered. I took tuberculosis before the antibiotic drugs, 163 days, hemorrhaging to death, on the edge of death, when my sister said, Oral, God's going to heal you. And my brother carried me to a tent meeting where a Holy Ghost preacher was laying hands on the sick, and God healed these lungs and loosed this tongue. I want to tell you, he's a healing God. He's a miracle-working God. And I want to tell you that when the last apostle died of that age, God began to raise up new ones, because in the second chapter of Ephesians, he said he built his church on the apostles and the prophets. And he gave five ministers in the church: apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. And he began with the apostles, and they're walking around in your midst right now. And they told him to shut up. I've heard that till I'm sick of it. I've been criticized, ossified, set aside. They have laid it on me. I have laid hands on more sick people than any man who ever lived. 1.5 million sick people individually. Now, I broke my shoulders, both of them, by reaching out all those years, laying on hands on people of 70 nations. I can't tell you what I went through. It's not important. But every time I raise these shoulders, I hurt. I have pain, and I've asked God to heal my shoulders. They cut on my right shoulder twice, cut on my left shoulder once, and he hasn't healed me. I've got a feeling that I know what Paul meant when he said, I bear in my body the scars of the Lord Jesus. I bear in my body, on my shoulders, the scars of the healing Christ. I bless God. I do it again. I do it again. I do it again. People have rushed up in the pulpit and hit me with their fists. They have spit on me. They have kicked me. They have sent bullets that just barely missed my head. But brother, sister, I'm alive yet. And I'm preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We have built a healing ministry. We built Oral Roberts University, founded on God's authority and the Holy Ghost, where your pastor recently came, Rod, came and set that place on fire when 4,300 people are on their feet with their hands up, praising God, speaking in tongues, magnifying God. Let me tell you, the days of miracles are not over. I'm in the midst of building a new television station in Tulsa, the last one that will be granted to Tulsa. And we're close. We intend to open it in September. I asked 44 men and women for $25,000 apiece. I only lack 40. And it leaves 10 at 50,000. I got one of those. I'm close to open it in September, debt free, for the glory of God. Let me tell you, God's miracle working power is alive. Look at this building. Look at this church. He was 29 when he built it. I was 29 when I started the healing ministry. Watch out for these 29-year-old men. They told him to shut up, and the Bible says he cried that much louder. They rebuked him. They told him what a bad guy was. They've told you that too. Don't kid me. Every one of you has been hit. Every one of you has had bad words said to you. Every one of you has been thought badly of. Why? Just because you wanted a miracle. Let me tell you a story. There was a little girl brought to my crusade about 11 or 12 with rheumatoid arthritis, twisted and full of pain. And I prayed for that child, and the Lord released her little buddy, and then I heard this story. She was bedfast with this terrible thing. Anybody who's seen rheumatoid arthritis strike children know what I'm talking about. But they let her watch television, and she watched me praying for the sick. And she convinced her mother to bring her to one of my crusades. And her mother dressed her and made the little bag, and they got ready to come over quite a distance until the neighbors heard about it. And they came in and said, "What are you doing? Where are you taking this child?" And the mother said, "We're taking her to the Oral Roberts Crusade. God's going to heal her." "He's going to do what?" "He's going to heal her." He said, "You've got to be crazy. You mean you're going to take this suffering child over these miles to this guy from Tulsa, Oklahoma, who claims that he can pray for the sick and God will heal him?" And the little girl said, "That's right." And the mother began to slack off. And they finally talked her out of it. And she turned to the little child and says, "Honey, we just can't go." And the little girl said, "But mother, you promised." "But honey, look what our neighbors say." And one of them spoke up and said, "You know how our church feels about this. You know that our church doesn't believe in divine healing." And the little girl said, "But mother, you promised." And the mother turned to the neighbors and said, "What can I do?" They said, "Don't take her." The little girl said, "But you promised." And the mother finally brought her. Well, but before she brought her, the neighbors really closed in on her. And when it looked like she's going to back out, the little girl said, "Mother, you're just stupid. Here I've been in that bed for all these months, and you've waited on me and cared for me, and you've cried. And you don't know if I'll ever get well. What if I don't get healed? I'm not healed now. What have we got to lose, Mother? What if I don't get anything? I don't have anything now." And said, "Mother, you're just stupid." And the mother agreed she was stupid. And she said, "All right, I promise." And they brought her, and the Lord released her. And somewhere in this nation, there's a woman now about 40 years old who is that little 11 or 12-year-old girl who's walking and well with the family. Folks, that's what counts, what God does. And Jesus, followed by that great crowd, while they were yelling and hollering at this poor blind man, rebuking him, heard the blind man's voice. Now, how could he hear? How big was the crowd? You know it was big. And they were yelling. And the blind man was saying, "Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me." How could he hear? There was a family that sat down to dinner, and they decided to record their conversation and hear it later. And during the dinner, one of their little sons said, "Please pass the butter." And nobody heard him. They kept on talking. The second time he said, "Please pass the butter." They kept right on talking. The third time he said, "Please pass the butter." They kept right on talking. Finally got up in his chair, stood up, and said, "Please pass the butter." His father said, "Son, you get it all down off that chair. Go to your room. You're not going to have any dinner tonight." and the little boy left. So after dinner, they took the recorder and began to play the conversation. And they heard this little wee voice said, "Please pass the butter." A little later, "Please pass the butter." Then, "Please pass the butter." And then, "Please pass the butter." "Look, friend, it's time to pass the butter. Somebody is up in a chair right now saying, 'God, please pass the miracles. Please pass the miracles. Please pass the miracles. Please pass the miracles.'" And you know, Jesus heard that little voice. This is a very special moment, because the devil has told you in different ways that God won't hear you. You know this is the truth. And the worse it gets, the more he says God won't hear you. And I'm talking to several people today who do not believe that God will hear you. On Larry King Live the other night, he was asking me about the 23 times I've heard God's voice. Does God speak to everybody? And I said, yes, but everybody's not listening. I'm no special person. I just happened to be listening. Because when you had tuberculosis in my day, you died. You died with it. Today you got a chance, but then you had no chance. I was listening. And he listened and he heard. And the Bible says he commanded them to bring this child. This is no little statement. He spoke to the religious critics and commanded them, "You bring this blind man to me, I'm going to heal him." You who are religious critics, denying the miracle working power of God, you think you're going to get by, don't you? God Almighty is speaking to you. "You bring those sick people to me. You bring those lost people to me." You give up your doubt and your unbelief. You start believing God. If you are a religious critic or an unbeliever today, God is speaking to you. "Bring somebody to me." Please don't pass that by lightly. He commanded them to bring the blind man. And they brought him. And this is what my sermon's all about. It won't take long, but this is it now. The other was the lead up to it. What do you suppose Christ said to the man? "Hey, fella, you realize you're interrupting our religious service? Do you think you ought to act like that when you're in my presence? But Lord, oh, hold on, let me talk to you. Do you see this great crowd here following me? This is a religious exercise. And you're yelling at me. Why would you do that?" You think Christ said that to him? No, that's people talking. Christ said, "What wilt thou that I shall do unto thee?" What did he mean? Be specific with me. "What wilt thou that I will do for thee?" Now there's a tremendous thought here for me and for you. With all of your troubles and mine, there's just one that can heal them all. Or if he doesn't, who can direct you to where an answer is? Why do we start with God when we've lost our job, our business, our family, our home, our health? Because if God does not do it supernaturally, he may have a natural force out there that he knows about that he can direct you to. He knows where there's a better job for everyone who's lost their job. He knows there's better health for everybody who's lost your health. He knows there's sight for everyone that's blind. He knows there's hearing for everyone who's lost their hearing. He knows there's walking legs for all legs that can't walk anymore. He knows there's money for all people who don't have any money anymore and are really poor. And he came to preach the gospel to the poor. Oh, that's going to take us all in, folks. Glory to his name. But he wanted to be specific about his own need. Many people will say, well, Lord, I want a blessing. There's nothing wrong with that. But did you ever notice that when you say, I just want a blessing, that you usually don't get what you ask for? Have you ever thought about what Christ said here to be specific, to say exactly what you want God to do? Have you ever stopped long enough to realize what the biggest need is in your life? What was his biggest need? He said, Lord, that I might receive my sight. Do you know most people would rather give up anything than their sight? If they had a choice to give up anything, it would not be their sight. Now think on that a moment. Jesus wants to know precisely what is wrong in your life. Doesn't he know? Yes. But he wants you to say it publicly. Now, listen real good, because this is going to cause us to squirm in a minute, but squirm good. This is a public place. There's thousands of people in this building. It goes out on television. This is really public. Now, that was a public place. The roads were, the highway was filled with people following Jesus. Jesus was passing by. The miracle was coming, and it was going. Somebody was going to get it, or it was going to go on by. This is a big moment. And this blind man sitting there expecting a miracle, he believed it would come to him someday, recognized it when it approached, and he reached out.